Okay. Multiversity introduces Dr. Lim Ma Hui, the author of a recent book, Nowhere to Hide, The Great Financial Crisis, Challenges for Asia, published by the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, Singapore. Dr. Lim has been working with several banks in the past, including the Asian Development Bank, JP Morgan Chase, CS First Boston, Deutsche Bank, and Standard Chartered Bank. Before being with the banking industry, he has been with research and teaching at Temple University, Duke in US, and University of Malaya. Dr. Lim has written on the Asian financial crisis, and the present book is on the present financial crisis. Dr. Lim, could you tell us the reason for this mysterious title for a banking book or a book on the financial crisis, Nowhere to Hide?
Yeah, the title, I guess I chose it because when the financial crisis hit us this time, if you're an investor, you have practically nowhere to hide your assets. That means all classes of assets are hit badly. Of course, it started with, you know, equity, and with bonds, with derivatives, you know, even with currency. Even if you're not an investor, like ordinary people like you and I, if you held a US dollar at that time, ironically, you know, the price of US dollar went up because people thought it was a safe haven, right? The Asian currencies went down, maybe 10, 15, 20%. But not as bad as during the Asian financial crisis. So what I'm trying to say is that this financial crisis is so large that it was like a tsunami that hit all over the world and affected everybody. That's the basis of the book. And then I also, in the other part, because it was written more for the Institute of Southeast Asian Studies, they wanted to have an Asian perspective to it too. So I drew up some lessons to see what lessons and implications it has for Asia in particular.
So by every crime, there is a person responsible. So who is responsible, in your opinion, for the present state of affairs?
Well, that's pretty dramatic way of putting it. Well, of course, the easiest way to say is that the bankers definitely are responsible, yeah. But beyond the bankers, of course, then you have the regulators who are caught asleep. But even more so, and in my book I deal with it, is that the academicians, the theoreticians, are also very responsible for this, because the practitioners, the policymakers, the regulators, people like you and I, derive our frame of thinking from science, right? In this case, particularly economics and financial theory. And I explain the causes of this crisis in terms of three levels. The first is the theoretical, ideological, and methodological failure of market economy, market fundamentalism, And the second level is the industry itself, banking, financial industry, right? The deregulation that took place since the 1970s, mid-1970s until today, which allowed the banks to take on humongous amount of risk, okay? And also to do a lot of things which they should not be doing, legally or illegally. So it's what I call the industry deregulation and malpractices. That's the second level. And the third level is we have to look at the fundamental macroeconomic structural problems of the United States as well as the world economy. Crises like this don't happen, well, it happens overnight. The causes don't happen overnight. Like pregnancy, you're born at one instant, but it took 9 months. And in this case, I think it took about 30 to 40 years for this problem to gestate. Okay? And so I look at what are the fundamental imbalances in the macroeconomic field. And I argue that there are three major macroeconomic imbalances. The first one, I think everybody knows about it, and you read about it in the newspaper, which is the imbalance of trade or current account imbalance in the world economy. Some economies such as China and many South Asian countries are having huge amount of current account surplus, and some countries, particularly United States, are having current account deficits. And this global imbalance cannot continue, and it's rightly pointed out. But I think moving beyond the macroeconomic, current account or trade imbalances, there are two more fundamental, in fact, imbalances, which I'm afraid many of the people who write about the crisis do not talk about. The second one is what I call the imbalance between the financial sector and the real economy. Essentially, some people use the word financialization. I mean, it's kind of a wordy phrase. But it means that the finance have become so big that it's what we call the tail is wagging the dog. That instead of the financial industry serving the real economy, it's actually dictating the real economy, and it's subjecting it to wild swings from prosperity to boom, to bust, this kind of bubble. So that's the second one. And the third one, I think, which is even less people talk about, is this whole question of inequality. I've been giving talks all over Asia as well as in America as well as Canada. And when I bring up this question, a lot of economists ask me, what's the relationship between inequality and financial crisis? I think there's a lot to be, said, and we can deal with it later, as you ask me more specific questions.
Now, what you're saying is there's some fundamental problem with economic theory itself, and that we are back to, if you're setting the counter, we are back to zero. And we've got to reformulate entire strategy of how to run economies, because market fundamentalism is never going to work, because it's going to keep on periodically creating these type of problems every few decades.
You're right, definitely. I think there's a very fundamental flaw in economics as well as in finance. And I pointed out two. In economics, and I want to quote Paul Krugman, who was the 2007 Nobel Prize winner, in his Lionel Robbins lecture in 2009 in the London School of Economics, he ended up by saying, much of macroeconomics has been useless at best and destructive at worst. And this is coming from, a well-noted economist. And I think one of the major problems, of course, it stems from the rational expectation theorist. That people, they want to build mathematical models of human behavior and economic behavior and all this stuff. And society is so complex. And therefore, you have to reduce this complexity to its individual components. And essentially what the rational economic theorists think, they assume that, since society is made up of individuals, let's study the individuals. What determines their behavior? How do they buy, sell, on what basis, what information they get, and all the stuff, correct? And then they build all this complex mathematical model, and then they think, okay, if that's how economic animal, human being behaves, we just aggregate it, and that's how society behaves. Okay? Now this is a fundamental philosophical and methodological flaw. What some academician calls it the fallacy of the composition. Now this is a big word, big phrase. What does it mean? It means it's fallacious. It's wrong to compose and decompose things. Let's put it in a way. Individuals behave a particular way, but then when you aggregate them, at the societal level, it doesn't mean the society behaves the same way. Okay? And to jump from one level of analysis, the individual, to the whole, that's fallacious. Or put it in another way, the whole, W-H-O-L-E, is more than the sum of its parts. That means you cannot just add like a mathematics, no, 1 plus 2 plus 3, no, is equal to X. Okay? Because the whole has some kind of, I wouldn't say existence, which is not directly related to the existence of the parts. You know, and some other ways, you know, you give you the example, I think Keynes talks about the fact of the paradox of savings. It's good for individuals to save, right? But if everybody saves, then the economy goes into a recession, see? Or, to put it another way, it's good perhaps for all the banks and companies to make a lot of profit. But if everybody, you know, does that, okay, does it really, benefit the society as whole? Yeah, sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. Take the case of today. The major problem that we face today is huge unemployment, correct? In the US, it's officially around 10%. Unofficially, some other commentators who have followed this thing, is you add on the people who are not looking for a job because they have given up hope, you add on the underemployed and all the stuff, you will come up to 15, 16, double the amount. It's huge. And why is this happening? Because at this juncture, companies want to maximize profit. They cannot maximize profit by increasing the top line, which is the revenue and the sales, because the demand is not there. How do they maximize profit? By cutting the cost. How do you cut costs? The easiest way is to lay off people. So they are maximizing profit. It's economically rational for each individual firm. They cut labor. If everybody cuts labor, you have huge unemployment. If you have huge unemployment, you don't have consumption. So business goes down. This is the fallacy of composition that is so clear. And the same thing with the banking industry. Every bank, tries to make a lot of profit by going to investment banking because it uses less capital than if you give the loan. Correct? And then investment banking activity is very, very volatile, very risky, yes, very profitable, But then what happens? You have this huge instability. That's the fallacy of composition, which I think economics have to, especially the rational theories, have to deal with. Then at another level is finance. Financial risk management is based on the statistical probability that events are distributed, financial events, like they think, physical events are distributed on a random basis, which is a bell curve, right? But we know, and actually we knew already, but we still ignore it. And today we know again that financial events are not distributed normally. They are what statisticians call fat tail distribution. To put it simply, that events that really should not happen, should never even happen, because it's a one in a trillion chance of happening, right? Happens with more regularity than we believe it is. And so let me quote you, in 1997 or 98, the long-term capital management, which was founded, is a hedge fund, which was founded by Nobel Prize winners and all the stuff, were taking huge bets. They thought that they had all the mathematical models to do arbitraging and this and that. Okay, yeah, so they were taking huge bets on the Russian bonds and all the stuff. And they think that, according to the mathematical models, it's one in a zillion chance that such things could happen. But it happened, and it led to their bankruptcy. And then after that, when it happened, the chief financial officer of LTCM said, what happened was a 25 standard deviation back-to-back event. 25 standard deviation is like one in a billion. And if back-to-back, is one in a trillion, it shouldn't happen. It should never happen in our lifetime, but it happened. Did we learn that lesson of 1998? No.